It's one of the biggest questions facing politicians right now. If the government's Three Waters reform don't happen, what happens instead? Pipes are bursting, cities are flooding, the cost of repairs is looking astronomical. And for more than a year now, National has been promising to repeal and replace the government's plan if they win the election. But replace it with what? This weekend, National finally released those plans, and local government spokesperson Simon Watts joins me now. Thank you very much for being with me this morning.
Morning, Jessica.
What's your plans and your policy going to do that the government's isn't? Let's just have a look at that first.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've announced our local water done well policy yesterday, four key components of that. One, to firstly repeal the Three Waters legislation that's on the table, get rid and scrap the mandated co-governed mega entities, restore council ownership and control, a key element and key point of difference, what the sector has been calling for. Thirdly, really ensure that we've got strict water quality regulations, but also importantly, strict investment regulations, which will ensure that money going in and collected for water rates actually goes into water infrastructure. And lastly, and I think the major point of difference is around ensuring that those planned for water services are financially sustainable. Because the challenge has been that money has been collected across the country in areas, but hasn't necessarily gone back into that investment. These entities need to be financially sustainable, and we've got mechanisms that will allow them to do that.
Let's go through the basics then. What will your plan do to the cost of water bills and to rates?
Yeah, well, look, we're very clear on this, that our policy position will be cheaper than Labor's mega entity bureaucratic model, which also has complex co-governance. And I think a conga line of consultants and bureaucrats that are lining up in behind that. We acknowledge that, you know, pipes and investment in infrastructure is going to need to occur. Our view is that actually putting the power with local communities is going to be a cheaper mechanism. Labor need to articulate clearly how they're going to build all these new pipes and culverts without anyone paying for it. And we've been very clear that actually we're going to provide access to long-term funding and financing mechanisms to match those long-term assets.
Great. So what will your plan do to the cost of water bills and for rates?
So our view is that it's definitely going to, under our model, rates are not going to increase. Are not going to increase in comparison to Labor's Three Waters model and the status quo. That is because we're going to be ensuring that these councils have financially sustainable plans and they have access to long-term debt funding. One of the major issues to date is that the borrowing for water infrastructure has been done on a short-term basis. We need to spread that long-term borrowing to match long-term assets. These are assets that last 30, 40, 50, in some cases longer periods.
Great.
And that's been the gap.
So let me give you a scenario then. We have an area and they amalgamate with others, they become part of that council-controlled organisation, they're allowed to borrow more because they're acting as a collective, and then their population shrinks, an industry closes down, for example. What happens then?
Yeah, look, the conversations that we've had, I'll give you an example of Hawke's Bay, which has been a group of four councils heavily impacted, as we know, in the last couple of weeks. Their proposal was to form a council-controlled organisation of the four councils in that region. They had the model in place. They believe that they could deliver all of the investment requirements in that region over the next 30 years and actually deliver some savings back to local ratepayers in terms of that model, but the government wouldn't allow that. And so I think the benefit of a regional council-controlled organisation is it does and will allow for changes within different communities, which, as you articulate, will happen. Things are going to grow, things are going to get smaller in different parts of the country, but we need a mechanism that's flexible enough to deal with it.
I just want to explain for anyone watching at home that perhaps doesn't understand what a council-controlled organisation is. It basically is when it's taken off the books from a council, and because they're able to work together, they can effectively borrow more than they could just as a single entity. But
yeah,
we've seen examples of that. I mean, Auckland Water Care, for example, in Wellington. Yeah. And it hasn't exactly been a stellar model of how things would work. So why do you think it would in this scenario?
And I think that is fair, because when you talk with ratepayers, there's real concerns around the fact that actually their revenue and their rates money going in to pay for these water assets hasn't necessarily occurred. Sometimes we've seen councils using that revenue to fund other nice-to-have things versus the actual water infrastructure. That's why we've got the investment regulator in place. That is really an important aspect in terms of making sure that we've got the right belts and braces around the overall model to make sure that these councils are investing in water infrastructures. They're ring-fencing the revenue that they receive, and it has to go back into water infrastructure. They're making sure that they've got revenue sufficiency, which means that these entities can stand on their own two feet. And they also need to be able to deal with growth, right? So a number of our councils are growing, and we need to be able to make sure that water infrastructure is not a blocker of more housing in this country, which it has been in some parts.
You talk about belts and braces, and when you take a step back, you're basically giving the control back to local councils, which arguably hasn't worked very well. You're not figuring out a comprehensive and big picture way of investing in this infrastructure that the government says will cost a lot of money. It seems like you're making tweaks and not being brave because it's a politically contentious policy. Isn't this just tweaks?
Absolutely not. I've spent the period of nearly the last 2 years out on the ground, more than 50 councils, working on with them and listening around what is the model that's going to provide a sustainable solution to water infrastructure. Simply an ability of creating four mega bureaucratic engines and adding complex governance is actually going to add more costs to the system, not less. As we've seen with the delivery of the cyclones and the way in which local communities have responded and actually dealt with the challenges locally, central government in many cases has been too slow to respond. And so what we've seen in the last 3 weeks, I think, reinforces and evidences that local communities are best placed to deal with these local assets. We need to put the right measures in terms of regulation around them, that they deliver water quality that is at appropriate safe standard, investment regulation around making sure that money coming in goes onto those water infrastructures, and their plans are financially sustainable. Because financial sustainability is a key difference between the status quo and Labor's three waters model. That is the key aspect that will ensure that what these councils do today is going to last for the next 30 years.
What do you say to the argument then that the councils haven't really done a great job? There are some exceptions, but haven't really done a great job of managing this. Why would you give them back control?
Look, I think actually in the main, most councils actually have done a good job. And there is a large number of councils across this country that are doing a good job. But there are councils that have not performed and have not invested in water infrastructure. That's why our plan, Local Water Done Well, ensures that we've got investment regulation in place to make sure that that is occurring. We've got the water quality regulation, and we've got the requirement for them to come back to the Minister of Local Government within a year with a plan to demonstrate financial sustainability. And we're going to give them the mechanisms, or work with them on the mechanisms, to allow long-term funding to match long-term assets. It's much cheaper in terms of, from a ratepayer point of view, to spread the cost over 30 years and spread it over 3 years. And today, it's spread over 3 years. And so it's quite a, you know, from a basic point of view of cost, you know, that's why we think our model is more financially sustainable.
What about, though, for some of those cash-strapped councils who then look and think, oh, well, let's sell off these water assets?
Well, look, if you're talking about privatisation, our model is absolutely categoric. There will be no privatisation of water assets. These assets belong in local community control and ownership. That is a bottom line, and it is categoric within our plans. And you know, there'll be absolutely no room or conversation around that.
What about PPPs?
We've been absolutely clear around the fact, again, that any privatisation of these assets is off the table. The local communities and councils will be given the responsibility to put together a structure that is financially sustainable. We are not going to mandate to them how they do that. It is up for them to determine the structure, but also, more importantly, how they govern those assets. Because I think our viewers, talking to our communities, is as these are assets that they have paid for over years and years, and they want to be involved with that decision-making process.
Let's talk about governing. What scares you about co-governance?
Look, we've been very clear around the fact that we absolutely do not support the mandation of co-governance of public services. And our model places the responsibility of how water assets are governed with local communities. Those local councillors are democratically elected by their ratepayer, and that is the group of individuals that needs to determine how those assets are governed. Co-governance has been a divisive conversation that has been amplified by the government's Three Waters policy. The feedback and the response from the public is very clear around the opposition of that topic. We've taken it completely off the table. It is not for central government to mandate. It's for local communities
but
to decide.
But what makes you nervous about it? Why are you against it?
We absolutely believe that it is not going to deliver better water infrastructure and better water services for consumers or for the New Zealand public.
What about the treaty obligations, though?
We absolutely acknowledge that there is rights and interests for water, but communities and councils already have really strong and robust relationships with Māori and iwi and hapu across the country. It is not for central government to try and come in and dictate that relationship. We councils have that relationship already, and we're empowering them to work with Māori, iwi and hapu to make sure that they are as involved and engaged as they need to be to make sure that these water services are delivered appropriately.
You said that it has been a divisive issue, and the Prime Minister has been quite vocal, pointing fingers at the National Party for contributing to that. Do you feel like the National Party's done everything it can to try and soften and explain what co-governance means to people?
Absolutely. And I want to give an example in Select Committee, because when Opotiki District Council came to us and said the three iwi and Opotiki District Council co-signed the agreement with Opotiki District Council in opposition to Three Waters and the government's opposition, government's Three Waters program. Why? Because they had significant concerns around loss of local voice, loss of local ownership. It's that community aspect and that community relationship that is so important. And so we've heard across the board opposition from iwi around the co-governed model, and our model places that back in the responsibility of councils and local communities, and that's where those decisions should be made.
Because basically what your policy is doing is it's giving control back to councils, it's compelling them to come up with a financial plan, and it's taking away co-governance. A lot of people will say, look, this has been a really expensive issue for a really long time. Mm. It needs a big picture response to this. Do you feel like this response that you're presenting, that you say, you know, you've been working on for a really long time, is dynamic enough to deal with the complexities of these issues?
Well, the key litmus test of this is it going to work or is it not, right? And the challenge with the status quo model by Labor around the complex co-governance is that no one buys into it.
And they isn't that the problem, though? Isn't it that they just haven't sold the policy?
They haven't listened to the people that understand this issue the best, and that is those on the ground within our communities. We've undertaken a bottom-up process to put together this policy, not a top-down. And through those conversations with communities across this country, we have listened to what they believe will work and what they believe will do it. That's what we've delivered. On top of that, we've put in place a regulation which makes sure that we have certainty at a central government level that we will deliver high quality and safe drinking water, we'll get the investment that is required, and most importantly, it'll be financially sustainable. There are tools and techniques in terms of how we fund and finance that we've put on the table, and we will work, as I've said right from the start, we will work with local government, not against it. We have to get that partnership and a degree and build that trust, because that is a key element of why we are where we are today.
You come from a finance background, so this probably is bread and butter for you. But a lot of people will be thinking, oh, we're just passing on debt to future generations. What's your response to that?
Well, there's no magic money tree. Right, the challenge with the Labor's Three Waters policy, as I said, they're going to build all these pipes and culverts, but they haven't articulated who's going to pay for them. And, you know, that is simply not the reality. Investment costs money, and our view is that we need to spread that investment over the life of the assets, because the pipes that we put in the ground today will benefit, you know, my children in 30 years from now. So we need to spread that amount of investment. That makes sure that the overall cost is less on ratepayers today and in the future, and we get that stuff done. We can't just simply, make this, and I've heard the Prime Minister use these numbers around $8,000 of rates increasing. Well, they're based on, you know, with respect, shonky assumptions from the Scottish Water Authority, assumptions around operational savings, 60% operational savings with no reduction in headcount. you don't need to be an accountant or anyone in finance to go, well, that doesn't really sound that realistic. And they aren't. It is simply implausible. And independent analysis has also said that the government's savings numbers are completely implausible. And, you know, I think Kiwis can see through that.
I do want to ask you a bigger picture question. Driving around New Zealand over summer, there were lots of signs about National repealing Three Waters. This is your first big, National's first big policy of election year. Do you really think that there's a big group of people who are going to be voting just on this Three Waters issue? What are you hearing on the ground?
Oh, absolutely. When I travel around the country, particularly in rural and provincial New Zealand, the concerns around loss of control of their water assets is significant. The implication of mandating co-governance into local communities is a significant issue. It's amplifying that lack of trust between our communities and government. And more importantly, people want to see water being dealt with in a bipartisan manner. It needs to be dealt with in a way that is sustainable, that we actually increase investment. Everyone in Parliament and everyone around the country agrees that more investment is required. It is a question of how we achieve that and how we make sure that is achieved in a sustainable manner. And my belief is that our policy will achieve that and will deliver those outcomes.
Well, that's a nice place to leave it. Thank you very much for being with me this morning. That's National's local government spokesperson, Simon Watts.